Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I just want to make a quick video and ask for a prayer request for a few prayers. The Lord's been showing me lots of things about the end times. We know that. And I, you know, if the Lord leads me to make videos about the things He's showing me, I will. I can only make the videos that the Lord is leading me to make. But barring the return of the Lord this month, barring the rapture, this month, I have a few situations that I would add. I need prayer today. I need prayer right away about, brothers and sisters. Number one, I have someone had let me borrow a car, and they unexpectedly need it back. And so, that's I need another vehicle to use. Say by the 1st of October, because my schedule's booked up in October. And the person needs it back, you know, in this. I basically need to get it back to them by the end of September. So anyway, so I got about 2 or 3 weeks here to make a plan. And, you know, we're right in the midst of all these things going on. You know, hopefully we'll be out of here. But, you know, there's, you know, I talk to brothers and sisters sometimes. And then, you know, there are, you know, people who believe the rapture is every day. Every day they get up and say, oh, the rapture is today. It doesn't matter what happens tomorrow. You know, when the rapture happens, of course it won't matter. But even though we may feel like the Lord is showing us when the rapture is and all these signs going on, we don't know 100%. And the Lord said He would come as a thief in the night. And we do not know the day or the hour. And a lot of people believe, including myself, that it probably alludes to the Feast of Trumpets. But it doesn't necessarily allude to the Feast of Trumpets. It could. Probably does, but you know, no one knows the mind of God. You know, God, His, as the Bible says, His ways are above our ways. You know, and so just as the heavens are above the earth, so are His ways above our ways. And so we can't know the mind of God. Only what He chooses to reveal to us. And then the second prayer request, it seems like the house parents, actually I've got two single females who are the house parents. Both of them are supposed to be engaged. I've got two single females, you know, women, who are the house parents of orphanage number 3, and it seems like it's not really working out that setup. And so I need prayers about getting new house, you know, a couple, Christian couple, to run orphanage number 3. Actually, I'm going to be, my plan is to stay at orphanage number 3. When I'm in the Philippines, but I'm not going to be there all the time. I'm going to be going back and forth to the States. By the grace of God, you know, it seems like I'll spend, you know, maybe 6 to 9 months a year in the Philippines and 3 to 6 months a year here in the States. So I need house parents there, brothers and sisters. So ask for your prayers about that, that the Lord will work it out, that we can get the right people there to do it. And like I said, when we started the orphanage, those of you who take the time to watch a videos about something besides end times scenarios, I appreciate that. You know, the, probably, you know, whenever, as you guys know, when you make a video about, you know, about the rapture or dreams and visions and all this, you know, I get double or triple the amount of views. When I make a video about the orphanage, like when I post the slideshows of the orphans or the slideshow of the feeding programs, I do two different ones. Usually I keep them separate. Sometimes I put them together. You know, the viewership is a lot less. You know, like I say, it always perplexes me, and I guess I'm kind of in a negative mood after, you know, this two, you know, bad news kind of coming at the same time. And that's the way it always is, right? When it rains, it pours. You know, I think about how the fact that people who are so excited for the rapture, the majority of them, you know, they're just thinking about themselves and thinking about the rapture. They don't care about, you know, others. As I've mentioned many times, the acronym JOY, you know, Jesus first, others second, yourself last. But the majority of people, that's, if you look at the famous preachers like this guy, Derek Prince, as an example, whatever his name is. Is that his name, first name? No, I'm talking about the guy who's a preacher there from Indonesia or whatever. I don't want to mention names, but Joel Osteen and all those guys, you know. when you listen to their message, it's, you know, Joel Osteen wrote a book like How to Be a Better You, and then he didn't even mention the Lord's name in the book. You know, the reporter from, I saw him interviewed like on Fox News, and the reporter even asked him, hey, you're a preacher, supposed to be the pastor of the largest church in America. You wrote a book about how to be a better you, which in itself is all about you. And then you didn't even mention the name of Jesus in there or anything. How do people get saved? You know, so to be a better you, the first step, of course, is to get born again. You know, and then God will bless you in the things that you do in your life. I mean, that's, you know, but, you know, that's, you know, the short version of that. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I think about that all the time. All the people that are so excited about the rapture, you know, that get caught up with the seeker-friendly, people-pleasing preachers. But they don't even stop to think about what they're going to do when they get there, when they go to the judgment seat of Christ. And the Lord says, you know, just like in, when the Lord comes back to earth, he will judge the people on earth and divide the goats and the sheep. Well, I'm sure he's going to be saying about the same things to us when we're in heaven, you know. As he says, you know, to all people, what you've done to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. You know, and so when someone helps, like the orphans, as an example, I mean, James, the half-brother of Jesus, said, you know, perfect religion is keeping yourself spotted from the world and helping widows and orphans. You know, so, and that's just one ministry. What the Lord, you know, has us doing in the Philippines is the feeding of the street kids, which I've, if you've searched my channel, I've, you know, I loaded, oh, probably a video once a month or every 2 months of the feedings that we do. We feed 1,000 street kids every week through churches, and then the families go to church, and then, you know, through that process, we're winning the families to the Lord through the children. That's the mission of Joshua's ministry. And then we have the orphanages in that, which we have 4 orphanages. And as I say, I'm asking for a prayer request because orphanage number 3, you know, and I just praise the Lord because the other orphanages are doing great. I mean, the house parents are doing great, and it's not an easy thing. You know, it's, you know, that's another thing. I mean, a lot of people have enough sense to realize it's not something easy to do. You know, watching somebody else's kids and a whole bunch of kids, you know, and, you know, trying to deal with disciplining them. You know, it's not like your own kid. It's a whole lot different dealing with somebody else. It's not your child. But there are many people who also don't appreciate, you know, I guess that's the down, you know, some of the downsides of social media. You know, not on my videos, but I've seen people's comments. A lot of cold-hearted, wicked, obnoxious people who, you know, who would think. I know the way they think. It comes to my mind because I read the comments on the internet and stuff, you know, that, oh, it's so easy, yeah. You know, maybe most of the people making those comments are a bunch of teenagers or something. I don't know. It's not easy taking care of a bunch of kids. Being a house parent at orphanage is one of the most difficult jobs in the world, if not, you know, in the top 10 of difficult jobs. And it's something that you have to be called to do. As myself, I mean, my calling is to oversee and administer these orphanages, not to be a house dad. Even though I can, you know, I can go there for short spurts and I can, you know, deal with them somewhat. So, you know, of course, I have a language barrier. But, you know, I'm not called by God to be a house dad, you know, working day to day with his kids. In my character and personality, it would be very hard for me to do. It would take, you know, I would need, you know, a Holy Spirit anointing to do it every day. Whereas some people have a natural calling and a love for it. Like our house mom at orphanage number 4, she loves the kids more than anybody. I mean, they're all the house parents are doing fine, but she really loves Sister May. She, at orphanage number 4, she really loves kids. And her husband only had one child, and they tried to have more kids. Their daughter's like 27 years old, and they don't have any grandkids. Their daughter's not married, and they wanted kids, and they just never had but that one. And they even invited their relatives' kids to live with them. They even raised some of their relatives' kids. You know, in the Philippines, like most families have about 8 or 10 kids. So some of their relatives let them, you know, like one of their kids go stay with them. And they just love kids so much. And it's really like their life's calling. So praise the Lord for that, you know. And more power to them. Let them do it. You know, like my calling from the Lord to preach. I love to preach. You know, I like to preach like a fish likes to swim. You know, that's my calling. And some of these other things, you know, it's not my cup of tea, as they say. It's not my calling. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I just came on here and I just asked for your prayers. And, you know, there's always, I always think about the way people think in these ways, but I have a mighty faith in the Lord. And you know, all the things, the name of my ministry before I started Joshua's ministry was Walking by Faith Ministries, that the Lord gave me when I first started out in 2001. I have extreme faith, brothers and sisters. You can't go, you know, to be a missionary if you don't have some strong faith, especially since I had no backing. I was using my own funds. The Lord made a way. And those of you who know my testimony, had a long-lost great-great aunt who never had children, who just happened to live near me. I lived near her, and I used to go visit her as a child all the time with my grandfather. That's his aunt, my grandfather's aunt. And then it just so happens that I bought a house near her, and she was in her 90s, and she needed help, and she didn't want to go to nursing home. She asked me to help her. It worked out. God made a way. And then, you know, just after she had passed away, just at that same time, matter of fact, it was like almost the same day, they wanted to build a shopping center on her land. You know, they got in contact with me. So the Lord made a way. You know, that's how I went to the Philippines in 2007. Well, I went for the summer, 2005, 2006, to make sure that the Lord really wanted me to go there. Because from 2003 to 2006, the Lord had led me to work with Filipinos in North Carolina. And I planted 3.5. I helped plant one and planted 3 Filipino churches that are still in operation today here in North Carolina. And then, so I started visiting their contacts there, some of my people and Filipinos working with me here. I visited their pastors and got connected with them there. Toured around, but I found a whole new area where I wasn't connected with any of those pastors. Down in Mindanao Island, and connected down there in the summer of 2000. Oh, actually, I went in 2005, 2006, then moved there in 2007, August 2007. As a matter of fact, it's almost anniversary. I think I moved there August the 17th, so it's almost there. Oh, well, past there. I'm sorry. This is already September. What am I thinking? anyway, so yeah, it's been since 2007. So what is that? 8 years ago, in August, I moved to the Philippines. And brothers and sisters, I did it all those things that were by faith. I used the funds from the sale of that land to build a shopping center, to do all the ministry work, brothers and sisters. I had no churches sponsor me. Now, because I'm not going to bow down to, you know, if you try to go, because I was accepted to be ordained through Assemblies of God, because I went to school through them. But the problem is, you know, there's like, oh, you're going to work with Assemblies of God groups here. It's not like, oh, you can go and work with Baptist and work with everybody. You need to work with our group only. And then, you know, it's like they're telling you where to go and what to do, instead of, hey, the Lord is leading me to go here and build a church or start a Bible school, whatever. No, you have to go through all these boards and all this stuff. And, you know, since I started, I've always been non-denominational. I've always been, you know, like a John the Baptist type in my ministry. So, thank the Lord. The Lord made a way that I didn't have to bow to these denominations and bow to their control over you. Now, accountability among pastors is one thing. And, you know, the pastors I work with there from all those different born-again denominations, from Baptist, Southern Baptist, Bible Baptist, Assemblies of God, Church of God, and several other different kinds of denominations, born again churches. You know, we have accountability, because if you're doing something right, wrong and all that, they're not going to let you preach in their church. And then, you know, they have a ministerial fellowship in these areas. So, you know, you have to be within the agreed bounds. So you still have accountability with other pastors. So, brothers and sisters, I did all those things by faith for the glory of God. And I thank the Lord for those opportunities to walk by faith. And then, as those of you who, I'm just saying this in case people didn't see it, you know, when my stepson died, his name was Joshua. That's when the Lord led me to start Joshua's ministry, which is a little child shall lead them. And suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. That's the two Bible verses that the Lord gave me. It's Isaiah chapter 11 is one of those, and I guess it's Matthew 19. I started Joshua's ministry, and that's the same time that it came on board that I started receiving donations in conjunction with that. And I already had orphans before. I had orphans, and I kept them at pastors' houses, and I used my money that the Lord gave me, and I gave to each of those pastors you know, monthly funds for those orphans, my original batch of orphans, which those of you who haven't seen my videos, I'm just repeating that for those who never heard it, because I think I've mentioned it once or twice over the 4 years that I've been on YouTube. But one of them now is a nurse. Her name is Diana. She's a nurse. There's another one that is a quality control person at a tuna canning factory. In the Philippines, down in the southern part of the Philippines, there's one city that's known as the Tuna City. And there's lots of tuna factories there. There's this place, Sarangani Bay. As a matter of fact, Manny Pacquiao is from the same area where she works. There is doing quality control. And they're all Christians. I'd wanted them to go into the ministry, but hey, it's up to the Lord. They can still, you know, participate probably by donations or something, you know, through the local churches where they are. And all my other orphans, well, you know, the other ones that were, they've got married. They were the other ones that were female, they got married. And one of them is in elementary school. One of them is the youngest one of my first batch, is about 8 or 9 years old by now. That a woman came, and I was at a church doing a revival at a Southern Baptist church. I was doing a revival there. And their pastor is a spirit-filled, spirit-baptized preacher. But, his first name is Vic, Pastor Vic. And it's a big church, too. He's got a great big church. I'll take that back. Now, 2,000, 1,500 people, maybe. A big church, especially in the Philippines. And a woman came there with a six-week-old baby. And she was trying to give it to the pastor and his family. And I was like, oh, man, I can't take this baby. But the Lord was telling me to take the baby. I had my translator there with me, a pastor from where I lived at. We're about an hour away from, or hour and a half away from where I was living. This was in Digos, a city called Digos. We took the baby, and I took it back there to where I was living at. And I placed the child there with a woman who's an old maid, I'll put it that way. She's, well, especially in the Philippines, people get married really young, probably, you know, like it used to be in the States. They get married about 18 or 16 or 18. A lot of people. But anyway, this woman is probably about 40 now, never been married. And so she's raising that child. She's a serious, strong Christian woman, and she wanted to have a child anyway. And so she's got a child. And, you know, so I've been, you know, sponsoring those before by faith, brothers and sisters. And then with Joshua's ministry, then the Lord made a way and really opened the door. And that's why, you know, I really became friends with Brother Gary. Bear 049. I mean, Gary is the one who contacted me about 6 months before Joshua died. As a matter of fact, it was in the spring of 2012. And Gary said that he wanted to make a donation to the feedings, and because I was been doing feedings since 2005. But just not that much, but we were doing feedings all along, the whole time. And Brother Gary told me, he said, you know, I want to make a donation to your ministry. I said, well, brother, I didn't take any donations because I don't want nobody, you know, kind of telling me what to do, you know, dictating, oh, if we give you the money, then you need to use it for this and use it for that. No, you know, people donate. It's for the Lord. And of course, it's for the needs of the ministry. Sometimes we buy guitars and give them away. Pastors in the mountain, they don't have electricity. So we give them guitars, you know, like I buy a guitar for like 30, 40 bucks. It's not a good guitar. A good guitar is, say, 100 or something. But they're going to carry it into the mountains, you know. They can fall down and break it easily anyway. So it's better to buy them a cheap guitar and then just buy a new cheap guitar every 2 or 3 years instead of buying a nice one. Because, these people are walking on foot 12 hours. And the one place that I went, you have to cross a river 54 times to get there. I mentioned that before. It's a winding river like this. And you can't really go over the top of the hills because it's covered with jungle. And there's wild monkeys there. And they can hurt you. There's wild boars there. And there's wild deer. But the deer in the Philippines, hind legs look like a rabbit. How about that? But they don't quite hop, but all, kind of a kangaroo-looking thing, kind of almost, in their hind legs. Anyhow, so, you know, these guitars would easily be broken. And then there's lots of pastors that don't have shoes. There's not many times I've given my shoes to pastors. And then I had some flip-flops that I wore back and walking 12 hours through those rivers because I gave away my shoes there. And the Lord knows, and that's why the Lord has blessed Joshua's ministry for those little things, brothers and sisters, that we can do for the Lord. Giving away guitars, giving away shoes, giving away dress shirts. One time in the Philippines, they wear these like a Spanish-looking thing called a barong, in the Philippines, maybe, I don't know what they call it in Spanish, maybe it's the same word, but it's a traditional looking shirt that you don't put the shirt tail in, with a design down the middle. You've probably seen it. Wealthy Hispanic people wear them, like in the Southwest and all that, like doctors and stuff, professional people. Well, in the whole world of, in the Philippines and that too, this, you know, if you're a pastor or a doctor or something like that, you'll wear one of these, or a politician, they wear them. Anyway, so one time at Christmas, I give them away many times. One time I went and bought, they had a big sale, and they were all handmade too. They're really beautiful. I bought about 30 or 40 of them, and I gave them away to all these pastors. What was so funny was, is a lot of this, they only had like large and extra large. Most of the Filipinos are about 5 foot something, not much. So they were like a dress on them, some of them. But what can you do? I mean, you know, that's all they had. And, I wish that, I'd had the funds to get them the right size. But, you know, they were still so proud to have it, brothers and sisters. That's the thing about it. They were still so happy and proud to have it, even though it was way too big. You know, and it was somebody gave them something. It really meant a lot to those pastors in the mountain areas, you know, because no one, they got shoes with cardboard in the bottom and all this kind of stuff. I mean, I know tons of pastors who don't even hardly have nothing to eat. And that's why one time there was a Baptist church, a Bible Baptist church in the States. In this area, I met their director of missions when I was here one time, and he wanted to give money, and then he was trying to dictate and demanding that the pastors send pictures that day they did the feeding and all this stuff. And, I had to deal with him. I said, we ain't going to be able to work together there, guys, because these pastors don't even have hardly shoes on their feet. These pastors don't even have hardly any food to eat, and you're talking about counting every single penny of what they get from you in the States, and you know, and they're in the middle of the remote area in the Philippines with no running water. They're using the river to use the bathroom and take a bath, and their own families hardly have, their own personal family doesn't have hardly anything to eat. You know, these people are just living day by day, and you're gonna, you know, in the middle of nowhere with no electricity, and you're demanding that they, you know, that they're gonna walk, you know, all overnight on Sunday night. They do a feeding, let's say Sunday afternoon or Saturday afternoon. You expect these pastors who don't even hardly have shoes and clothes to wear, and they've got their own families to feed. I mean, they also have like some of the pastors have like a coffee. They own some coffee, like a, you know, one half of a hectare or one fourth of a hectare or an acre of land, and it's full of coffee beans, and that's their livelihood. They're farmers. Maybe they have coconut trees or something. They gave those native peoples, the government, you know, they have like their land, and they, you know, like in America, they have a special deal with native people. You know, to occupy that land, that tribe, maybe they have, you know, 10,000 hectares, and then, you know, they have tribal rules to divide it up and all that by families, you know. So that's their livelihood. And you want them to walk 12 hours crossing the river 54 times to come to the nearest town with the internet, and they've never even used the digital camera and take pictures and carry that camera and hook it up to the internet and send pictures and all this immediately that day for your report. No. These people are all volunteers. These people aren't making any money. They even asked me, can we eat? When we feed the people, can we also eat? Those pastors asked me, you know, can I have something to eat too? Yeah, you can have something to eat. You know? And so that's the kind of things that you deal with, brothers and sisters. The cold-heartedness and hard-heartedness of so many people that say they're Christians. And like I say, what I do 99% of the time, brothers and sisters, in order to make it, I don't look at I don't look at those people. I don't think about those people, because if you start thinking about, the self-centeredness and the selfish and the cold-heartedness of people, so many people that claim to be Christians, you know, it will blow you away. It will discourage you, you know. And so, I'm saying all that because cliches. There's so many people, brothers and sisters, who have cliches, but unless you've walked a mile in somebody's shoes, you can't do that. And that's the whole thing, just like when you're talking. You know, I think the Lord, with any kind of a group, you know, not every group, but lots of groups, even like the homosexual people, you know, who, there's several homosexual people that's got saved watching my videos. Now, I've never been gay. I've never been homosexual. But from all the hardships and experiences I've had in the Philippines in the ministry and dealing with different people as a pastor, I've learned that, hey, you know, as the saying goes, except for the grace of God go I, but what Paul said in the Bible exactly was, he said, by the grace of God, I am what I am. You know, so God made me. And so that's why I have even though I'm not a flamboyant, entertaining, entertaining clown show on YouTube too much, you know, to get people to watch my videos. But I believe that through all I've been through, it's given me a lot of humility and empathy, and that's really the big medical term there is empathy. And in the Bible, and like in the King James, Jesus said in the last days, the love of many would wax cold. And that's what it is. And then the medical term, as I said, is empathy. Lack of empathy. Lack of, as Bill Clinton used to say, I feel your pain. When he really, well, maybe he did. I mean, that's why he was popular with people, because he sympathized with them in their situation. Or they thought he did. He was able to pretend like he did. Anyway, he was a great actor, so you have to give him credit for being a great actor, right? Anyway, brothers and sisters, after I've done all my rambling now, and like I said, I usually don't talk about the ministry, but, I need to make another slideshow of the orphans and the feeding programs. And, you can join us on the Facebook group, and I really thank the Lord. The Lord has made a way. It's by faith, on my part, by faith. And praying and believing, and I know there's many of you have prayed and believed with me for the orphanages to be built and the debt to be paid off. And as a matter of fact, really, I only have $10,000 left to pay off of, because I actually borrowed, as you guys know, I borrowed $60,000 to purchase that orphanage number 3 because the Lord led me to, and it was the right deal, a great deal. It was really half price, and barring the return of the Lord and barring, unforeseen future, property values in the Philippines are going up because there's lots of Chinese. China has been prospering, and they're buying up places all over Asia, so it's boosting the value of the property. So, the Lord led me to buy it, and I believe the day will come. It's up to the Lord. Lord, barring the Lord's return, we could sell it for a huge profit and maybe buy land in a outside, more of a rural area, and buy 2 or 3 orphanages with the value of that property. So these kind of business deals and all that, that's not my forte either. My forte is preaching, basically, only. Praying with people, preaching, and praying for people to be healed and delivered and all that kind of stuff. Words of wisdom, words of knowledge. Ministry, that's my thing. Administrative stuff is not my thing. But the Lord has taught me that. I've learned to learn to tolerate administrative part of the ministry, of being a missionary. Before I totally disliked it, and now I've learned to see it as it's okay now. I'm lukewarm to it. I'm a Laodicean in administrative task. So praise the Lord for that. The Lord has made that change in my abilities. He's increased my abilities to handle it. So I thank the Lord for that, brothers and sisters. I thank the Lord for His blessings, increase of humility and patience and endurance to finish the race that the Lord has called Joshua's ministry to run, and I'm just I am just a facilitator of Joshua's ministry. The Lord is using me as the vessel to do this work that He wants to do. And I'm just along for the ride. I'm just a willing participant in the Lord's plan. And that's what the Lord calls us to do. As He says in Romans chapter 12, to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, meat for the master's use, as the King said. King James says, worthy for the master's use, to have ourselves repented and all those things, read your Bible, pray, repent and all those things, worship the Lord, have a close relationship with the Lord, and then, He can use you as a vessel of honor, not a vessel of dishonor, as it says there also in Romans. I believe that's chapter 9, maybe. I can't remember all of the time, brothers and sisters. Anyway, I'm not really in a preaching mode right now. I'm just in a talking mode. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to thank all those who have been praying for Joshua's ministry. We've been able to accomplish a lot. Now, hopefully, and praise God, the rapture will be this month, and we've run the race the best we can. And God has given us the grace when we haven't, when we've fallen short, He's given us the grace to repent and be forgiven, and His mercies are new every morning, as the Bible says. But if we're still going to be here, brothers and sisters, that's the imminent prayer request I have. I need to have a vehicle really by the end of the month. Ask you to pray about it. The Lord's going to work it out for me. I need a vehicle to get around, and I'll be going back to Philippines. Actually, I guess my finalized plan will be I promised people I would come to Vancouver and Seattle and up in that area, and I've just gonna, it's kind of on the way to the Philippines, and so I'll probably just go. I don't think I'll travel in September except for to return this vehicle to another state. But anyway, brothers and sisters, it will be the beginning of December. I will be in Seattle, brothers and sisters. Lord willing, I'm planning to be up there basically the 1st of December. Seattle and Vancouver the first 2 weeks of December. And Portland, then approximately December the 15th, by the grace of God, we'll be in the Philippines. And I've got to, you know, get this worked out. I mean, with orphanage number 3, at the house, those two sisters who are doing the house parents, you know, they're going to hold on until then, by the grace of God. And then I got to get that worked out. And then whatever else the Lord has planned, to do revivals and crusades in the Philippines, as the Lord has already talked to me about, barring his return. But anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. And I thank you for listening to me in my, you know, in my Job moment in this video. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. And I thank you all for your wise counsel and prayers and assistance and advice on all these things. Also, let me just throw it on here because I've already been talking a long time. Of course, we're having another child, and we haven't signed up for Obamacare. We came, you know, in here in May. So the enrollment period, you know, that we missed all that. But the baby's not due till March. So, you know, I need to pray about whether we will sign up for Obamacare or have the baby in the Philippines. It's cheap, real cheap to have the baby in the Philippines. But, you know, you have to process the baby's citizenship through the embassy there, the American embassy in Manila. And it's cost of that and the time and everything kind of makes it about even if you have a good insurance. You know, the cost of delivery is down. So I ask for your prayers for these things and even advice of people that know these things about us having the baby. Because really another thing too, I don't have family support here. I have family, but I don't have any family support. You know, my family's not really Christian. So I don't have family support here, you know, from my wife. And we need family support. We've got a 4-year-old that I've got to watch. And I can't be with my wife if I'm watching him. Harley puts us in a jam, things like that. And my wife's going to, you know, need help when we after we have the baby. And, you know, I know the Lord knows that I've been left in this, you know, in this position. You know, and like I say, I don't like to think negative. After, you know, all the years I've been serving the Lord. And then, you know, it's, we don't have a support from my family. And now my wife's family in the Philippines, I've got 4 sister-in-laws. So we have good support in the Philippines. So it's sad and it's a shame, you know, and I try not to, you know, accentuate the negative or even think about, you know, the fact that, you know, as far as family goes, we're alone here. And, you know, what can you do? That's how it is. And those of you who, you know, who have a strong family, good parents and brothers and sisters and whatnot, you know, you're blessed. You're blessed to have that. Because there are some of us, and there's people I know who talk to me that don't. And it's very difficult. It's very difficult, you know. And then, like I say, my wife, my mother-in-law's died. My father-in-law died last year. My mother-in-law already died in 2008. She had a heart condition. In the Philippines, to die at 50 years old is already old. My mother-in-law was about 50 when she died, and it wasn't even a big deal. That's just like average there in the Philippines. And so anyway, my wife doesn't have that support here, and so I ask you guys to please pray for that. Also, because, you know, I spend, and I'm not trying to, I guess I am whining, but I spend my days from the time I get up to the time I go into bed serving other people and serve, you know, for the Lord. And, you know, and when you give and give and give, and you know, if you start thinking about it, there's a few of you that probably do the same thing. When you give and give and give and give, and then you're just like, you know, it makes it very hard to push forward. And it's just by sheer, you know, guts and faith that I've been doing it these years. And so anyway, brothers and sisters, that's why I just ask for your prayers to finish the race. And of course, I'm going to. Or, you know, there's no doubt about that. But that's the thing about, you know, things are not always perfect in this life. We know that. They never are. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. And I thank you for your prayers and your brotherly and sisterly counsel. Thank you.